Well, a very warm greeting to you, friends, this morning, and we welcome you to worship at Wisbech Salvation Army. A very warm welcome is extended to those watching at home. You're very welcome to join us this morning, and we thank you for joining us for our worship this morning. And this morning, friends, is all about loving God and loving others. Now, I was motivated and actually inspired by this theme because our church organisation, our church body, has recently released a new mission statement, a statement in which we as a church are encompassing all of our ministries and all of our devotions. Hence, the new slogan up there, you can see it, love God, love others. So this morning, as we worship our Lord and Heavenly Father, we're going to explore what that means for us. We're going to explore the depths of scriptures, what that encompasses in our own hearts. And it is our solemn prayer this morning that we are able to relish in His Spirit by loving God and by that extension, loving others.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah. Yes, absolutely. It's always a cause for hallelujah, especially when it comes to loving God. But before we commence in our worship this morning, friends, I just invite you just to share a word of prayer with me. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege that is ours to come and meet with you this way. To meet with you in the many varieties, be it physically in the hall, virtually online, or in the comfort of our own homes. Father God, we give you the glory this morning, and it is our prayer that we are able to love you, God, our Heavenly Father, that we are able to love each other, and that we are able to radiate that in our hearts, in our minds, and in our ministries. Be with my friends this morning, Lord, as we just commence and worship your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Amen. Now the first song we're going to be worshipping together through this morning is Joyful, Joyful. Because you know what, friends, loving God and loving others is in itself a joy to our hearts. So for those of you who have a songbook, it is 39 in the Salvation Army songbook. Those watching online, if you have a songbook, number 39. The words, as always, will be on the screen. And we're going to be accompanied by the Region Hall Band through this video. Now, we will be accompanied not so much with a congregational singing, but more of a band. But either way, friends, this is our time to worship. So if you are able, I just invite you to stand as we just share in this song together. Joyful, joyful.
Thank you.
I know it was a little different not having much of a congregational backing, so yes, you were forced to listen to each other sing for a change. Bit of an advantage for me, I'm all up here on the end, but I can hear myself sing through the speakers. But the next song is in keeping with our theme of loving God and loving others. And actually, it is a reciprocal love that we show to each other through the love that God shows us. And it's because of this reciprocal love that this next song is Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. It is number 455 in the Salvation Army songbook, 455 in the songbook. As you have already done, friends, feel free to remain seated, except for Christina, the camera lady, as we just sing this next song together. Blessed Assurance.
Yes.
praising my Saviour all the day long. There's no better way, friends, than to love God than through praising, through our song, through our prayers, and actually through the precious gift of fellowship. Everything to do with praising our Saviour is loving God. And what a blessing and a privilege that is to say that Jesus is mine and that we worship him through his blessed assurance. Just a quick note, friends. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, good, because I just looked down at my battery pack and I'm flashing low battery. Whether that's the Lord's way of saying we have no more words or low batteries, be made of that as you will. I just wanted to gauge if you can hear me okay. But I am going to transfer to the lectern mic just for this next bit. And we sing our songs through the joyous praise of singing. But also about that, yes, thank you, Paul. Also about praising our Saviour and lifting our voices to your song, there's also the call to worship. And the message behind the calls to worship, our responsive prayer, is the same as it is as we raise our songs in voice. We raise our songs in prayer to prepare our hearts and our minds for worshipping our Heavenly Father. And for our prayer ministry this morning, I'm inviting you to be a part of this call to worship. Very momentarily, you'll see words on the screen. But I realise that the board can sometimes have low resolution. So for whatever reason you can't see the words on the screen this morning, feel free just to bask in the words that are uttered this morning. But I invite you along to where it says all, to just share in the call to worship, divided amongst myself and you guys. Jesus commanded, love one another. We come to worship the God who is love, that we may learn to love one another. Jesus says, no longer do I call you servants, now I call my friends. We come to worship the God whose friends we are through Christ. Let us sing praise to God and live in love and friendship toward each other through Jesus Christ. When we do not accept as our sisters and brothers in Christ those who are different from us, forgive us, O God. When we oppose you by opposing those who disrupt our routines and challenge our assumptions, forgive us, O God. When we willfully disobey you and lose faith in your future, forgive us, O God. God, in your mercy, restore us to newness of life. Bind together your church, universal through the coming of your Holy Spirit. Empower us to witness with courage to the presence of Jesus Christ among us. And the church said, Amen. Amen. And Father God, we just lift our prayers, our thoughts, our call to worship up to you this morning. We wish to extend those prayers outward to our church family, those who are missing physically this morning, for those watching our line, and for those within our community, Lord. Father God, you commanded us to love the Lord our God and to love each other. And Father God, we just pray that our prayer just relishes in our hearts and in our minds this day. And Father God, as we continue worshiping you this morning, we just pray that you will continue to draw close to us through the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray these things in your precious name. Amen. Amen. And now, before Paul brings us our announcements this morning, we're going to be offering once again through our giving and through our tithe this morning. So, the usual routine. Once Paul plays the reflective melody, we have the freedom to deposit our tithe and offering in the collection plates on the holiness table. Alternatively, as always, feel free to give in the end of the meeting, should you so wish. But now let us give in our tithe and in our offering. following which then Paul will bring us our announcements. Thank you, Paul. Except for Wednesdays, unless you wish to be praying amongst a bunch of toddlers and parents, which we don't do on Wednesdays now. Right. As we explore this concept of loving God and loving others, as Jesus himself commands, we're going to be exploring the scriptures in which Job brought us so dutifully, what that means for us entirely. But I must say, friends, loving God and loving others sometimes isn't the easiest thing, is it? It requires a lot of willpower. It requires the Spirit's presence and the Spirit's power. And it's with that in mind that we continue worshipping that Spirit's power, the power of Jesus' name. And it is with that we're going to sing our next song together. All hail the power of Jesus' name. It is number 73 in the songbook. But as always, the words should be on the screen for you all to enjoy. Feel free to remain seated or stand, whatever your heart's desire, as we sing this next song. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Lord of all. I don't think there's any more testament to that itself, is it not, friends? To crown him, our Lord Jesus, the Lord of all, to love him supremely, and as he says to us, love one another. Fair warning, Christine, I need to get the 10,000 steps in today, so if I'm wandering around as I preach, then bear with me, folks. But this concept of loving God and loving one another requires the Spirit's power. And with that in mind, I'm reminded of this torch. Think of any electrical device at home, whether it be a power drill, a torch, anything that requires power. For it to work efficiently, then it simply needs to have batteries, does it not? Because without batteries, you will see that it doesn't illuminate. It doesn't work properly. No matter how many times I push this jolly button, which as you can hear is a lot, it will not come on. I can't help but feel, with the concept of loving God and loving each other, sometimes I feel that we need that sense of the Spirit's power. We need that deep-rooted grace of Christ. No matter how many times we push people's buttons, sometimes it just won't work. And I'm sure we've all pushed people's buttons in trying to make things work. Have a lot of friends. But the single prospect of power makes things work. So when you put batteries in, you'll see, I'll try not to blind anybody there, but you'll see that it is illuminated. The advantages, I see where the flashlight is, so I'm not blind anybody. But you can see, friends, that with power, things work. Things are illuminated, and things function as they should. And Jesus is saying in his message to the experts of the law, he is saying, you must love God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your minds. That is the Spirit's power. And when we engage in the relationships of today, we must follow and heed that vital instruction. It's not always easy, as I've already said. Loving can sometimes be an arduous task. And that's because we are naturally, friends, we can be self-centered. I've been guilty of being self-centered myself. But thank goodness for the loving grace of Christ to wash away such transgressions on my character. I will not always be perfect, just like all of us. We'll never always be perfect. But that is what the grace and love of Christ is all about, friends. It is about empowering us to love with all of our hearts, souls, and minds. And though we may fall and trip and stumble along the journey of life, we may stumble along the way, but it is that saving grace that we are able to pick ourselves up again and continue on and press on in our love for God and our love for others. Paul put it quite squarely in 1 Corinthians 13, verses 1 to 3. It says, if I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels, but didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy and knowledge, and I had such faith that I would move mountains, but didn't love others, I would be nothing. If I gave everything I have to the poor, even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it. But if I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. This is from the extract on a very well-known piece of scripture on love. But Paul is saying here, without love, all of these deeds would mean nothing. Without that power, I can click all day long, it would mean nothing. We need to have that empowerment of love for it to be worthwhile. But Paul, arguably the biggest evangelist in history, is saying, without those things, I, Paul the Apostle, am nothing. And that is such a profound statement, possibly and arguably one of the greatest Christians to have ever existed, in saying, I am nothing without love, and I am nothing without showing this love. So, as I showed you before, I was quite encouraged when our church envisioned this for its mission statement, to love God and to love others, directly derived from Jesus' very own teaching. Now, what I've come to learn from the Salvation Army since joining the church and leaving Brentford's a jolly lot. I'm a jolly lot in the church. But we are not just an evangelical church, nor are we just a social enterprise, or a string of charity shops, or a homelessness network. You would agree that there are so many identities within the Salvation Army, identities that we are known and renowned for across the country, or across the world even. We take a stance in social action. And don't get me wrong, having so many various identities has its advantages, but it can also have its disadvantages. And the main disadvantage of this is if we disagree and we are divided about our vision, our mission, and our values. That is why this really inspires me, because this encapsulates all of our mission. Everything that we do, no matter who we are identified by, we must do it by loving God and loving others. And we communicate that, not just globally, nationally, internationally, but even amongst ourselves in our community. We must love God, and we must radiate that. And it goes without saying, we must love others. Love God, love others. And as I said, that is through the power and grace of Jesus. If you look in your Bibles, it is entitled the greatest commandment. He says it himself, it is the greatest commandment. And just to add a little context here, the religious leaders of the time, the Pharisees, they loved being people who were right about everything. Have you encountered somebody who just loves to be right, like all the time? Without fail, they must be right. They must be the be all and end all, and their word must be law. Is it not? Forgive the pun, but the religious leaders of the law, they saw themselves as such people. They saw themselves above politically and theologically from those around them. The Sadducees, the Gentiles, the down-outs of community, they saw themselves as above. And because of that, they felt the need to dictate this law. I did a little research into this passage, and it turns out that the Pharisees and the religious leaders of the time state 613 different command statements. 613 different commandments taken from Scripture. And out of that 613, 248 were positive, hooray, and 365 were negative. Don't do this, don't do that. Between you and I, friends, that's a little bit much. And it begs the question, where is the love? There was no secret that the religious leaders were agitated with Jesus. There was no mistake in that. But they saw this as an excuse to flex their political and theological muscles, rather than actually absorbing the precious scriptures themselves sometimes. They saw themselves as above everybody around them. And that is counterproductive to loving God and to loving others, is it not? An expert of religious form naturally asked this question in verses 35 and 36. One of them, an expert of religious law, tried to trap him with this question: "Teacher, which is the most important commandment in the law of Moses?" And Jesus, knowing the hearts of these people, answered with a double love statement, which encapsulates the entire Hebrew Bible. Forget the 613. He answered with the double love command statement, to love God and to love others. And he puts it very plainly, friends. As it says on the boards, there is nothing more important than to do that. Loving God and loving others. And this forms the very core of Christian ethics. As I said, friends, everything who God made us to be, part of this church, this forms the absolute center of how we must conduct ourselves. Jesus replied, "You must love the Lord Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment." Now, this reminds me of our founder, General William Booth. Back in the day, well, first is a bit of context to today. I am notified from head office with emails and statements almost on a daily basis. I remember coming home from honeymoon, I had 78 emails to answer. And for me, it's absolutely ghastly. It was the worst thing to come into. You've got to go through all these emails. But I tell Jesus, I just thank God I'm notified. But back in William Booth's era, they didn't have such technology. They didn't have computers or emails. But they did have telegrams. Now, I have to watch my knowledge here, because I'm not overly familiar with telegrams. I believe it's the things you type on the typewriter, is that right? Well, either way, the messaging back then was a lot more archaic than it was today. And William Booth, to communicate to all of his officers, all of his volunteers, and all of his friends, would issue telegrams. And encapsulating this ethos, he sent a very profound telegram. And it was this. Others. That's all it was. One word, full stop. Others. Signed, General Booth. It makes you think, what would you do if you received this telegram? The fact that it just said others, did he forget to write anything else? Or was it a misprint? Well, no. William Booth knew what he was going through with this message. It was very plain and simple. Others. Minister to others. Love others. Love the Lord your God and love others equally. That is the ethos behind this singular, one-worded telegram. As you know, in the early days of the Salvation Army, we cared for the lost, for the poor, to give the pundit, for the down and outs, that were considered down and outs in society. William Booth had a heart for such people, and he wanted his officers to know such, so he put others. Frederick Crutes, another general of the Salvation Army, said this: for the believer, the love and service of God are the springs from which issue the call to love and the service of men. So all he is saying here, much like being empowered by the Spirit, it is within us. It is through the love of God that we are able to love God and love others, to share in our ministries, make that impact to others, and actually to ourselves as well. Though the theme today is love God and love others, we must love ourselves equally. Sometimes we can be too hard on ourselves. Let us relish in the love of Christ. Let us relish and feel good about who Christ has made us to be. For that is what Scripture declares. Now, as I said, it was no secret that the religious leaders at the time cared out for Jesus, which, by the way, I found quite ironic. Because the whole concept of love God and love my neighbour only extended to the Jewish community. And Jesus was a Jew. Just a bit ironic if you ask me. They didn't even love their own Jewish community. But as I've said before, they were not interested in learning and absorbing the scriptures in their hearts and minds. All they were interested in that particular moment of scripture was defeating Jesus. Defeating him theologically and politically. And Jesus, in my opinion, sets the precedent. You must love from within. Jesus quoted the Shema to them, essentially. That love God and love others. Listen, O Israel, found in Deuteronomy. That is the Shema. And the Shema, just to give you a bit of context, is a Hebrew phrase. It's a statement of faith practiced by Orthodox Jews. So the fact that he quoted the Shema to the Jews should resonate a powerful message. It should resonate that message to them. He was doing so with absolute authority, friends, not just then, but for back then, for today as well. It is a testament. That's what I know about Scripture, friends. It is a timeless fruit that we can take forward into our today's ministries. And that is what is so exciting. And that is what we must fuel ourselves on. Verse 37, as was already on the board, heart, soul, and mind. It is all within us. We must embrace and lavish the grace of Jesus in our hearts and in our minds for this to be effective. And amidst all of the cards, all 365 of them, we can do love. We can do love in our hearts. We can love, serve, and be obedient to his word and be obedient to his call. And love ourselves in the process as well. We must love ourselves. Jesus is essentially saying, if you truly love God, then these commandments will come very naturally. And we come across such loving people in life, don't we, friends? The that it just comes so naturally about. And I'm inspired by a lot of Christians who just naturally radiate this love in their very beings, the auras from which they surround themselves. We need to surround ourselves with such people. And what's so encouraging is we can be such people. That is what's so encouraging. It is not on a pedestal, that is unachievable. We can be that loving source, not only for ourselves, but for others. And I thank God on almost a daily basis for such a blessing. Like the torch I showed you at the beginning, like all devices, it requires power to work. You can click on it all day and it will never work. For it to work, for it to illuminate, for it to be a source of power, we must draw that power from the Holy Spirit. We must seek God actively and just pray to God, Lord, just lavish yourself on me now, Lord God. Just be in our hearts and minds. And it is with encompassing from the Spirit that we are able to achieve, as the song suggests, so much more than we can measurably dream of. As we just conclude and reflect on loving God, loving others, and loving ourselves, we're going to be worshipping through the next song together that, in my opinion, is encompassing of such messages, and that's the power of your love. The source from which we originate our ministries, originate our love ourselves, comes from His power, comes from His love, and we must reciprocate that for others. And so, very momentarily, we're going to be reflecting on what this means for us, loving God, loving others, and loving ourselves. And as this song plays, as this song just erupts in this hall, as you sing along, be it audibly, online, or very quietly, solemnly in our hearts, I urge you to do one thing, friends. I urge you to just dig deep in the Spirit's power. Seek Him with all of your heart, soul, and mind, as Jesus has said, and say to God, I am ready, Lord. I am ready for this love. I am ready to show this love to others, and I am thankful. I most certainly am, anyway. This next song, The Power of Your Love, is taken from 601 in the songbook. So that's 601 in the Salvation Army songbook. But the words will be on the screen, as always. And this video is taken from Wisbech Salvation Army through their worship. So, however you choose to spend this next song, singing audibly or in your hearts, I just urge you just to contemplate this important power of love. Love God and love others. Let us worship the Lord.
Oh,
to love others and to love ourselves through the very power you lavish upon us. Help us to seek you, the loving Father, to relish in the sacrifice of Jesus, and to be empowered by the Holy Spirit, not only as we leave this place, but as we just go about our day-to-day lives. Help us to radiate the power of love, to love God and to love others. Be with those of us who couldn't make it with us this morning and for those watching online. May your Spirit's presence draw close to our friends. And we give you all the glory, the majesty that is your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray these things in your precious name, your name, Lord, that is above every name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us this morning, friends. And for those watching online, we just pray that God's blessing will be upon you this day as well. And as I mentioned before, friends, as you leave this place, do enjoy tea and fellowship in the GP room. And before you leave the building, do take an up-to-date worship at home or prayer diary, should you show your desire. But as always, be blessed, be a blessing, and may God bless you richly.
Hallelujah.